Tonight we are going to be looking at a figure in the New Testament and the Old Testament whose life is prophetically spoken about, probably second only in detail to our Lord Jesus Christ. And the person we're going to be looking at is the person of the Antichrist. Because there's so much, if you listen to different Bible teachers, on the, whether it's on the radio and TV, there's a lot of different teachings about the Antichrist that are just are out there. And so what we want to do is we're going to look, I'm going to take you on a roadmap tonight of the texts within the Scripture that specifically speak about this figure. Because this guy's life is mapped out from a certain introduction that's going to take place of this person all the way to his destruction. And it's a fascinating study. And it begins in the book of Daniel. The first passage that I'm going to take you to in Daniel tonight is Daniel chapter 9. And chapter 9 and in verse 24. This is a passage, was one of quite a few passages that convinced me as an agnostic that the Bible was for real. Because growing up, and you know, everybody has their doubts. And they think, you know, and I always thought that the Bible was, you know, maybe taught some good moral stories and things like that, but that you couldn't believe it or take it literally. Well, this passage in Daniel is something that just shook my foundation as far as that was concerned, because here Daniel gives a very specific prophecy concerning two people, the Messiah and also the one who is commonly known as Antichrist, and we're going to see how we get that. Fantastic. We're going to be reading from the Holman Christian Standard. It's a 21st century translation, and just kind of breaks the English down in a little bit easier to read format. Okay. 70 weeks are decreed about your people, the Israelites, and your holy city, to bring the rebellion to an end, to put a stop to sin, to wipe away iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place. So here, this is actually the angel Gabriel revealing to Daniel this prophecy. And he says 70 weeks, which is also in the Hebrew, very simply, 70 sevens. Okay? That word weeks in the Hebrew is a Hebrew word shabua, and it literally means a seven. So we have 70 sets of sevens are decreed for your people to accomplish all of these things. And we know that all of these things have not yet been accomplished, like sealing up vision and prophecy hasn't been done. Putting a stop to sin hasn't been done. So there are certain things about this prophecy that have not yet been fulfilled, just from looking at the points that are brought up in this very first verse in 24. In verse 25, he goes on and says, "Know and understand this. From the issuing of a decree, of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince will be 7 weeks or seven sevens and 62 weeks." Okay, so 7 plus 62 equals 69, but there are 77s to the whole prophecy, remember. Okay, it will be rebuilt with a plaza and a moat, but in difficult times. The issuing of the decree to restore, and I'm going to go over this. This whole prophecy is a study in and of itself. So I'm going to go over the first part of this pretty quickly because I want to jump into the passages on the Antichrist. But just some facts about this verse. The issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem is recorded in Scripture and happened in 444 BC. King Artaxerxes, the scripture reference is actually Nehemiah chapter 2, where King Artaxerxes I, who was a Mede-Persian king, Jerusalem and the nation of Israel had already been destroyed by the Babylonians. And King Cyrus in the Mede-Persian Empire gave a command to restore and rebuild the temple, which the Jews had the permission to do. But then King Artaxerxes later on in 444 BC gave the command to restore and rebuild the city of Jerusalem. And Daniel prophesied this. This is going back about 600 BC. Okay? So he's prophesying something 150 years before the events took place. When you take 444 BC, okay, it's going to break down this for you in the start here. When you go from 444 BC and you count 69 sevens, okay, 69 times 7 happens to be 483, okay? 483 years after that period, and when you count leap years and all that other stuff, I tell you, this is a study in and of itself. It brings you actually to AD 32. When Messiah the Prince would be introduced. So here is hard biblical evidence of the exact timing when the Messiah would be presented to the nation of Israel. This passage of Scripture, by the way, is skipped over in synagogues around the world when they have Haftorah readings. It's like forbidden study by the rabbis for laymen. This is because it reveals the exact time when the Messiah would come. Very powerful passage. Then in verse 26, after the 62 sevens, the Messiah will be cut off and will have nothing, or he will appear to have nothing. The people of the coming prince will destroy the city and the sanctuary. Even that passage is just so mind-blowing. He's telling here, right here, this Messiah who would come would be cut off and would die. In the King James Version, he would die, but not for himself, is another translation. Or appear to have nothing, because he would die for us. He would be dying for our sins. So two events we see that's going to happen after 69 of these sevens is that the Messiah would be cut off and that the city and the sanctuary would be destroyed. And that happened in the year 70 AD when Titus and the armies of Rome went in and destroyed Israel, Jerusalem, and the temple. Okay, and here it is foretold around 600 BC. Now, it says the end will come with a flood, and until the end, there will be war, desolations are decreed. Now, talking about this prince to come, it says the people of the coming prince will destroy the city and the sanctuary, which they did in 70 AD. But then it says this prince who was to come, he will make a firm covenant with many for 1 week or 1 7. So we got the first 69 sevens in the first part of this prophecy. Then we have this last period of seven. Okay? Two events, Daniel says, would happen in between the 69th and the 70th seven, which would be the crucifixion or the death of the Messiah and the destruction of the temple. Then you have this last period of seven, saying that this prince to come will make a covenant with the many, talking about the people of Israel, because this prophecy concerns the people of Israel, for 1 7. But in the middle of that seven, but in the middle of the week, he will put a stop to sacrifice and offering. Okay? Right now in Israel, there is no sacrifice and offering. So a lot of biblical scholars will look at this verse and say, okay, as a result of this covenant that he's going to make with the people of Israel, there's the implication that the temple will be rebuilt and the Mosaic sacrifices will be instituted again. But in the middle of this last seven, he will come and put a stop to the sacrifice and offering. You can't put a stop to something unless it's going on. And the abomination of desolation will be on a wing of the temple until the decreed destruction is poured out on the desolator. So here we have the introduction of this Antichrist, of this person who's going to make a treaty or a covenant with Israel. In the middle of those 7 years, that last period of seven, he's going to go back on his word. He's going to set up something which Daniel refers to, or the angel refers to, as the abomination of desolation. One thing that's beautiful about the scriptures is scripture will generally never leave you hanging when it's given details. There'll be other things that are going to fill in the gaps. So we're going to look at some of these other gaps concerning this person who's going to make a covenant with Israel for 7 years, go back on it after 3.5 years, and then at the end of those 7 years, there's going to be destruction that's poured out on this desolator. And we're going to find out about all this. We're going to turn now to Daniel chapter 7. And we are going to go down to verse 7. In Daniel chapter 7, in the entirety of this chapter, God reveals to Daniel the four kingdoms that would come out of the earth. The Babylonian kingdom, the Mede-Persian kingdom that would follow, the Greeks, the Grecian Empire, and the Roman Empire, all before it happened. But we're going to be focusing on the last. And in verse 7, he says, "While I was watching in the night visions, a fourth beast appeared, frightening and dreadful, and incredibly strong, with large iron teeth. It devoured and crushed and trampled with its feet whatever was left of the Grecian Empire. It was different from all the beasts before it, and it had 10 horns. While I was considering the horns, suddenly another horn, a little one, came up among them. And three of the first horns were uprooted before it. There were eyes in this horn like a man's, and it had a mouth that spoke arrogantly. As I kept watching, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white like snow, and the hair of his head was like whitest wool. His throne was flaming fire. Its wheels were blazing fire. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from his presence. perhaps the lake of fire. Thousands upon thousands served him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was convened and the books were opened. I watched then because of the sound of the arrogant words the horn was speaking. As I continued watching, the beast was killed and its body was destroyed and given over to the burning fire. As for the rest of the beasts, their authority to rule was removed, but an extension of life was granted to them for a certain period of time. I continued watching in the night visions, and I saw one like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was escorted before him. He was given authority to rule and glory and a kingdom, so that those of every people, nation, and language should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will not be destroyed. Fascinating passage, because when Jesus was standing before the Pharisees upon his when he was being tried, they asked him plainly, "Are you the Messiah, the son of David?" And Jesus quotes this passage from Daniel, and he points to him, and he's saying, "This is talking about me." Yes, there was unmistakable doubt concerning who Jesus claimed to be. But continuing in Daniel, he continues and he says, "As for me, Daniel, my spirit was deeply distressed within me, and the visions in my mind terrified me. I approached one of those who was standing by and asked him the true meaning of all this. So he let me know the interpretation of these things. These huge beasts, four in number, are four kings who will rise from the earth, but the holy ones of the Most High will receive the kingdom and possess it forever." Yes, forever and ever. "Then I wanted to know the true meaning of the fourth beast, the one coming from all the others, extremely terrifying, with iron teeth and bronze claws, devouring, crushing, and trampling with its feet whatever was left. I also wanted to know about the 10 horns on its head and about the other horn that came up, before which three fell, the horn that had eyes and a mouth that spoke arrogantly and that was more visible than the others. As I was watching, this horn waged war against the holy ones and was prevailing against them until the Ancient of Days arrived and a judgment was given in favor of the holy ones of the Most High. For the time had come and the holy ones took possession of the kingdom." So here we see just from these passages that you got this last, Daniel calls them the little horn, okay? And that from the last empire, there would be 10 kings who would come out. These are the 10 horns. And they have this little horn who's going to subdue three of them. And this one's going to be a real big mouth. He's going to speak arrogantly. He's going to blaspheme God. He's going to, this is the one who sets up what Daniel says is the abomination of desolation. And very interesting, Daniel brings up, and Jesus himself refers to the abomination of desolation in Matthew chapter 24 when Jesus is asking the question, what's going to be the sign of your coming? You know, what's going to happen before you return? What are we going to see? Jesus refers to the prophecy we just referred to in Daniel, but Daniel talks about the abomination of desolation in other places, which we're going to look at also. But let's finish in chapter 7 here. This is in, 23, that's where we're at. This is what he said. "The fourth beast will be a fourth kingdom on the earth, different from all the other kingdoms. It will devour the whole earth, trample it down, and crush it. The 10 horns are 10 kings who will rise from this kingdom. Another, different from the previous ones, will rise after them and subdue three kings. He will speak words against the Most High and oppress the holy ones of the Most High. He will intend to change religious festivals and laws, and the holy ones will be handed over to him for a time, times, and half a time. Okay? Or in short, 3.5 years. You have a time, which is one, and then times, which is two. 2 + 1 = 3, and then a half a time, 3.5. John and Daniel actually even break it down into days later on, 1,260 days, which is equivalent of 3.5 years, according to the Bible's use of those words. So we see, though, too, that during the reign of the Antichrist, the saints of God are going to be persecuted severely. They're going to be, the scriptures plainly say, they're going to be given into his hands. He will have power over, over the saints in that day. There's going to be severe persecution to Christians who are on the earth while he is present. But then he continues in verse 26, but the court will convene and his dominion will be taken away to be completely destroyed forever. The kingdom, dominion, and the greatness of the kingdom under all of heaven will be given to the people, the holy ones of the Most High. His kingdom will be an everlasting kingdom, and all rulers will serve and obey him. I know sometimes, and even my own kids don't like hearing about end time prophecy sometimes, because, you know, you hear about all these things that are going to happen on the earth, and how, you know, even what we just read, how the saints are going to be handed over into the power of the Antichrist during that time. But man, we have such an incredible future before us when these things take place. This is why when you belong to Christ, I'm going to tell you something I got to share with you too, because when I first became a believer, you know, I became a believer in Jesus. I repented of my sins and placed my faith in Christ, and still didn't know really where I stood on the Bible at that time as a young Christian. And as I started reading things, and I'm just going to be totally honest with you, when I started reading things about the second coming of Christ and he would come in the clouds, this is when I started thinking, oh, you know, okay, maybe these guys are running a little wild with their imaginations and stuff. But then when I started really studying the nature of prophecy and the literalness that it has been fulfilled, it made me realize the reality of this passage. Because, you know, the scriptures foretold that the Messiah would be pierced in his hands and his feet. That was literal. That he would be betrayed for 30 pieces of silver. That he would, all these things, events that would happen in his life. There's so many more prophecies about the second coming than the first coming. And the Bible is so graphic in its description of what's going to happen. So if you belong to Christ today, you know, don't let end time prophecy get you down. Because what that's telling you is we are that much closer to his return. And when he says, I will descend on those clouds, you could, that's going to be, what a sight. You know, it's going to be so glorious. We have such a future ahead of us. We're going to have bodies like him. Like when Pastor says, we'll be able to have Haagen-Dazs and not worry about the calories. Okay. In chapter 8, in verse 23, we get some more details about the Antichrist. And it goes on to say, near the end of their kingdoms, when the rebels have reached the full measure of their sin, an insolent king, skilled in intrigue or skilled in deceit, will come to the throne. His power will be great, but it will not be his own. He will cause terrible destruction and succeed in whatever he does. He will destroy the powerful along with the holy people. He will cause deceit to prosper through his cunning and by his influence. And in his own mind, he will make himself great. He will destroy many in a time of peace. He will even stand against the prince of princes. Yet he will be shattered, not by human hands. Yeah, another powerful passage. And here Daniel really clarifies who is going to destroy the Antichrist at the end of time, at the end of the age. And it's going to be the Prince of Princes, Messiah the Prince, that Daniel refers to in chapter 9. The vision of the evenings and the mornings that has been told is true. Now you must seal up the vision because it refers to many days in the future. I, Daniel, was overwhelmed and lay sick for days. Then I got up and went about the king's business. I was greatly disturbed by the vision and could not understand it. All these things that were being revealed to Daniel was still yet for a time. If a person sits with the scriptures and really puts their heart to study, Bible interprets itself. This is not really that difficult to understand. Everything I've just read to you straight from the scriptures. Is there anything, though, just I would like to pause right here. Is there anything that's unclear to anyone about what I've read? Or does anybody have any questions about anything? Okay. You? No, I thought I saw your hand go back up there, brother. Antiochus Epiphanes? Okay. That's the one who slaughtered the pig in the temple. Okay. Do you know what year that took place in? I think that was during the time of the Maccabees, if I'm not mistaken. Very easy answer to that. Because if that was the fulfillment of that prophecy, Jesus would have never quoted it in Matthew 24 as an event that would take place before his coming. He would have said that already happened. The abomination of desolation has already been set up and is finished with. But Jesus points to it as a future event. Yeah. And that's that prophecy of the 77s from Daniel. There are people who will, and Christians who will say, oh, that these events already happened. I don't believe that, in this whole eschatology thing, I'm not going to drive myself crazy with that. That would be valid if Jesus said that these things didn't happen yet. Jesus said in Matthew 24, perhaps we'll take a look at that too there, but these events culminate in the destruction of the Antichrist and the second coming of Jesus, the setting up of the Messianic kingdom, the kingdom that will have no end. That hasn't been done. That's why these events, that last period of seven in Daniel's prophecy of the 77s, has yet to be fulfilled. Very short period of time, relatively speaking. It's only 7 years. But so much in the Bible is addressed to that last period of seven. It's just everything we've read so far. It all is addressed in that, talking about the last 7 years of this planet as we know it. Okay, next passage of Scripture. We're going to go to Daniel chapter 11. And we are going to go to verse 29. At the appointed time, he will come again to the south, but this time will not be like the first ships of Kittim. Ships of Kittim will come against him, and being intimidated, he will withdraw. Then he will rage against the Holy Covenant and take action. On his return, he will favor those who abandon the Holy Covenant. His forces will rise up and desecrate the temple fortress. They will abolish the daily sacrifice and set up the abomination of desolation. Here we have another reference to this abomination of desolation that Jesus refers to in Matthew 24. Again, talking about the temple. So Daniel brings up the ceasing of sacrifices, this coming against the temple. It's all implications that the temple will be rebuilt after that covenant is signed with the Antichrist. So just a word, just from what we've read so far on biblical teaching that we've just read so far, things that we should be looking for prophetically, okay? And this is why Pastor Graziano on Wednesday nights is emphasizing these events that are happening in the Middle East. All this pressure happening in the Middle East is going to culminate in what has to be one of two different things, either the destruction of Israel by the surrounding nations or a peace treaty, okay? And the scriptures foretell that there will be a treaty, a covenant with the people of Israel. So when we see that happen, and as a result, a rebuilding of the temple, know that we have entered that last period of seven, according to what we've read. Okay? Very, very powerful stuff. Something that shook my attention as a young man, and I'm, again, just being straightforward with you, there was a period of time when I had backslid after I had became a Christian, and I started not paying attention to the things of God, and my walk with the Lord had really grown cold. And something that really brought me back to the Lord and brought me back to my knees is I saw on the news that they were laying the foundation stone for the rebuilding of the third temple. And I remembered from studying prophecy when I first became a Christian that this was a monumental event that would take place before the second coming of Christ. So that was something that really caught my attention. And they today in Israel have priests who are trained and being trained to carry out the sacrificial services of the Mosaic law. Like, they're preparing for this already. And the Jews are excited to get their temple rebuilt and to institute the sacrifices. So even everything that Pastor's been sharing on Wednesday nights, all the pieces of the puzzle are just being put together. And the scriptures have foretold it all before it would take place. But when we see that happen, wow, that's going to be a pretty exciting time. Okay. Where are we here? Verse 32, very good. Okay. With flattery, he will corrupt those who act wickedly toward the covenant. But the people who know their God will be strong and take action. Those who are wise among the people will give understanding to many, yet they will die by sword and flame and be captured and plundered for a time. Does anybody not understand that? That's pretty self-explanatory. When defeated, they will be helped by some, but many others will join them insincerely. Some of the wise will fall so that they may be refined, purified, and cleansed until the time of the end, for it will still come at the appointed time. Then the king will do whatever he wants. He will exalt and magnify himself above every god, and he will say outrageous things against the God of gods. He will be successful until the time of wrath is completed, because what has been decreed will be accomplished. He will not show regard for the gods of his fathers, the god longed for by women or for any other god, because he will magnify himself above all. Instead, he will honor a god of fortresses, a god his fathers did not know, with gold, silver, precious stones, and riches. He will deal with the strongest fortress. He will deal with the strongest fortresses with the help of a foreign god. He will greatly honor those who acknowledge him, making them rulers over many and distributing land as a reward. At the time of the end, the king of the south will engage him in battle, but the king of the north will storm against him with chariots, horsemen, and many ships. He will invade countries and sweep through them like a flood. He will also invade the beautiful land, and many will fall, but these will escape from his power: Edom, Moab, and the prominent people of the Ammonites. He will extend his power against the countries, and not even the land of Egypt will escape. He will get control over the hidden treasures of gold and silver and over all the riches of Egypt. The Libyans and the Cushites will also be in submission. But reports from the east and the north will terrify him, and he will go out with great fury to annihilate and completely destroy many. He will pitch his royal tents between the sea and the beautiful holy mountain, but he will meet his end with no one to help. We're going to go through chapter 12 too, if you don't mind, because this is also pretty descriptive. At that time, Michael, the great prince, Michael, who's the archangel in charge over the nation of Israel, who stands watch over your people, will rise up. There will be a time of distress such as never occurred since nations came into being until that time. But at that time, all your people who were found written in the book will escape. This event here, talking about Michael the archangel and fighting, who stands watch over your people will rise up. The book of Revelation goes on further and talks about the war that's going to take place in heaven between Michael and his angels and Satan and his angels, and how they will be cast to the earth. And Revelation puts it right in the middle of that 3.5 years, which is when the Antichrist sets up the abomination of desolation. Many of those, in verse 2, chapter 12, many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to eternal life, and some to shame and eternal contempt. Right here in the book of Daniel, in 12:2, we have the prophecy of the resurrection of the dead, both the righteous and the unrighteous. In the scriptures, there's always, while there have been resurrections that have occurred, like the resurrection of Lazarus, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, even in the Old Testament, Elijah and Elisha raised people from the dead. When the scriptures talk about humanity in general, both in the book of Daniel and in the New Testament and in the book of Revelation, it talks about two resurrections of humanity: the resurrection of the righteous and the resurrection of the unrighteous. So if you ever wondered, will everyone be resurrected? The answer is yes, everyone will be resurrected. In the book of Revelation, John even gives us the exact time when these resurrections will occur, which we'll look at if we have time. Okay, verse 3. Those who are wise will shine like the bright expanse of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. That's who we want to be. We want to lead people into a relationship with our Lord. Those are the ones who will be like the stars, who will shine forever and ever. But you, Daniel, keep these words secret and seal the book for the time of the end. Many will roam about, and knowledge will increase. Then I, Daniel, looked, and two others were standing there, one on this bank of the river and one on the other. One of them said to the man dressed in linen, who was above the waters of the river, "How long until the end of these extraordinary things?" Then I heard the man dressed in linen who was above the waters of the river. He raised both his hands toward heaven and swore by him who lives eternally that it would be for a time, times, and half a time. When the power of the holy people is shattered, all these things will be completed. I heard, but did not understand. So I asked, "My Lord, what will be the outcome of these things?" He said, "Go on your way, Daniel, for the words are secret and sealed until the time of the end. Many will be purified, cleansed, and refined, but the wicked will act wickedly. None of the wicked will understand, but the wise will understand. From the time the daily sacrifice is abolished and the abomination of desolation is set up, there will be 1,290 days. The one who waits for and reaches 1,335 days is blessed. But as for you, go on your way to the end. You will rest, then rise to your destiny at the end of the days." And that's how Daniel concludes his book. Just profound. And if one puts their heart to learning and to study, they can understand. Because the times, as we look back on history now, because we're looking at it from a complete... Daniel was looking into the future, and man, it was so hard to put two and two together. We're looking now back on time and seeing how prophecies have been fulfilled and have come to pass. And, you know, if we just look at the scripture at face value, let scripture interpret scripture and not apply wacky meanings to things. Let the Bible interpret itself. It's not that difficult to understand. Now we're going to go into Revelation. Just let's pause here for a second. Is there any questions at this juncture? Yes. Uh-huh. Yep. If we go from the time that the abomination of desolation, okay, because it's giving that as the period of time, and we count, you know, I don't even have a calculator on me, but that works out to 3.5 years, okay? Yep, absolutely, to the day. There's going to be something that happens within those days, really, that kind of, that where it doesn't explain, but Daniel says, whoever makes it past that time is blessed. You know, so, yeah, absolutely. And this is also, this is the third of three passages that talk about this abomination of desolation. Again, referencing the temple, the ceasing of sacrifices, you know, when you tie it all together. So the timeline, you know, it's given in Daniel chapter 9, in that prophecy of the 77s, and then it's kind of further explained as you go throughout the book of Daniel. And right here in chapter 12 is where he actually gives the days, the number of days. Yeah, absolutely. And there's no reason to spiritualize the days. Like there are sometimes people who say, oh, well, the Bible says one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years. Okay? And one day is with the Lord as 1,000,000 years, too. You know, because with God there is no time. But when Daniel says this is going to happen at this time, and we've seen 483 years of those 77s literally come to pass to the day when Christ came as Messiah the Prince, there's no reason to spiritualize the last 7 years. It's 7 years, exactly as the first 69 sevens were 483 years. Okay. We are going to go into Revelation chapter 11. Oh, you know what? No. Okay. I'm going to take you to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Because John writes quite a bit about the Antichrist. But so does Paul. So we're just going to kind of see some things that Paul has to say. And interestingly, you're going to see Paul using the same exact words that Daniel used. Okay? Because these are things that the Apostle Paul was extremely learned in. And in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and in verse 1, he says, "Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers, not to be easily upset in mind or troubled either by a spirit or by a message or by a letter as if from us, alleging that the day of the Lord has come. Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the apostasy comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction. He opposes and exalts himself above every so-called god." Here is Paul is quoting Daniel chapter 12, exactly what we were just reading. "Or object of worship, so that he sits in God's sanctuary, publicizing that he himself is God." Okay, the Thessalonians were being told that, "Oh, the day of the Lord has come," and you know, Paul's saying, "Don't stress. That hasn't happened. These things have to happen first. Don't you remember that when I was still with you, I told you about this? And you know what currently restrains him so that he will be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. But the one now restraining will do so until he is taken out of the way, and then the lawless one will be revealed. The Lord Jesus will destroy him with the breath of his mouth and will bring him to nothing with the brightness of his coming." Paul's quoting Old Testament. This is the beautiful thing about the scriptures. It's in perfect harmony with each other. No contradictions. "The coming of the lawless one is based on Satan's working." Remember in the book of Daniel, it says that he will have power, but it won't be his own power. It's going to be by Satan's power. "With all kinds of false miracles, signs, and wonders, and with every unrighteous deception among those who are perishing. They perish because they did not accept the love of the truth in order to be saved. For this reason, God sends them a strong delusion so that they will believe what is false, so that all will be condemned, those who did not believe the truth but enjoyed unrighteousness." And you know, and I don't have to tell you, as you know, as my brothers and sisters, there are certain people you could talk to about the Lord, and even though in their heart they know it's right, they're too happy in their sin. They don't want the thought of repenting of a sinful lifestyle is the furthest thing from their mind. And when this Antichrist comes on the scene, the man of lawlessness, the scriptures foretell, Jesus says it in Matthew 24, and Paul even makes it clearer right from this passage. There's going to be false miracles that are going to take place. We're going to see, we have a little bit more time. We're going to go into Revelation. He's going to survive a wound to the head as if he's resurrected. There's going to be a false prophet who also performs. There's going to be miracles that these guys are going to do that the rest of the world, who are see it to believe it, they're gonna fall for it. They're gonna fall like flies. The scriptures say the whole world will wonder after him. You and I are gonna look like the nuts. Okay, let's go to Revelation chapter 11. Okay. We're going to start down in verse 15. The seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, "The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and his Messiah. He will reign forever and ever." The 24 elders who were seated before God on their thrones fell face down and worshiped God, saying, "We thank you, Lord God the Almighty, who was and who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. The nations were angry, but your wrath has come. The time has come for the dead to be judged, and to give the reward to your servants, the prophets, to the saints, and to those who fear your name, both small and great." And the time has come to destroy those who destroy the earth. God's sanctuary in heaven was opened, and the ark of his covenant appeared in his sanctuary. There were flashes of lightnings, rumblings of thunder, an earthquake, and severe hail. Very interestingly, that is the last trumpet of seven trumpet blows. And the Apostle Paul says, at the sound of the last trumpet, the dead will rise. In the book of in Matthew 24 and also in 1 Thessalonians, they talk about the trumpet sounding before the coming of Christ. But in any case, so John, in his vision, I'm sorry, I read that as a precursor, but in chapter 12, he says, "A great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and a crown of 12 stars on her head. She was pregnant and cried out in labor and agony as she was about to give birth. Then another sign appeared in heaven. There was a great fiery red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns." Here's those 10 horns again. "And on his heads were 7 diadems. His tail swept away a third of the stars in heaven and hurled them to the earth. And the dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she did give birth, he might devour her child." The woman is Israel. The 12 stars were the 12 tribes of Israel. Okay, this is a vision that correlates exactly with the Old Testament when Joseph saw his brothers bowing before him. And Israel is represented as the woman who gave birth to the Messiah. And the dragon wanted to destroy the Messiah at his birth. "And the dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she did give birth, he might devour her child. But she gave birth to a son, a male who is going to shepherd all nations with an iron scepter. And her child was caught up to God and to his throne. The woman fled into the wilderness where she had a place prepared by God to be fed there for 1,260 days. Then war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon and his angels also fought, but he could not prevail, and there was no place for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was thrown out, the ancient serpent who is called the devil and Satan, the one who deceives the whole world. He was thrown to the earth, and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, 'The salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah have now come, because the accuser of our brothers has been thrown out, the one who accuses them before our God day and night. They conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they did not love their lives in the face of death. Here again, we see this: when Satan is cast out of heaven and his angels, and they come to this earth, we're going to enter that last period of the last three and a half years, that last 1,260. And the scriptures say the Christians who are on the earth at that time, again, just like Daniel said, would be given into his hand. But they did not love their lives in the face of death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you with great fury, because he knows he has a short time. When the dragon saw that he had been thrown to earth, he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child. Persecution of Israel. The woman was given two wings of a great eagle so that she could fly from the serpent's presence to her place in the wilderness, where she was fed for a time, times, and half a time. From his mouth the serpent spewed water like a river flowing after the woman to sweep her away in a torrent, but the earth helped the woman. The earth opened its mouth and swallowed up the river that the dragon had spewed from his mouth. So the dragon was furious with the woman and left to wage war against the rest of her offspring, those who keep God's commands and have the testimony about Jesus. We are, when you get down to it, the offspring of Israel, because our faith, when you get down to the core of it, is Jewish. Jesus was Jewish. Yeah. I talk to some people who think otherwise. It's amazing, the different views that exist out there. So Satan, when he's cast down, again, it's just a reiteration there of the persecution that's going to be happening against Israel and against God's people, those who bear the testimony of Jesus Christ. He stood on the sand of the sea. Now, here's another interesting one. And I saw, continuing in chapter 13, and I saw a beast coming up out of the sea. He had 10 horns and 7 heads. On his horns were 10 diadems, and on his heads were blasphemous names. The beast I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like a bear's, and his mouth was like a lion's mouth. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. This is why the Antichrist is not Satan himself. Satan is the one who gives him his power. And here in Revelation chapter 13, a very clear distinction is made in case there's any confusion. And it just also confirms what Paul said too, how the Antichrist will come with the working of Satan and by the working of Satan. Now listen to this. One of his heads appeared to be fatally wounded, but his fatal wound was healed. The whole earth was amazed and followed the beast. They worshipped the dragon because he gave authority to the beast, and they worshipped the beast, saying, "Who is like the beast? Who is able to wage war with him?" So this guy's going to be a very powerful individual politically, religiously. When people see the peace that he's going to bring, his so-called resurrection, he is going to be healed from a mortal wound, a fatal wound. This guy's going to be Time's Man of the Year. Anybody who brings peace to the Middle East is going to be Time's Man of the Year. He's going to be, the world will wonder after him, just as the scriptures say. A mouth was given to him to speak boasts and blasphemies. He was also given authority to act for 42 months, 3.5 years. He began to speak blasphemies against God, to blaspheme his name and his dwelling, those who dwell in heaven. And he was permitted to wage war against the saints and to conquer them. He will also give authority over every tribe, people, language, and nation. All those who live on the earth will worship him, everyone whose name was not written from the foundation of the world in the book of life. of the Lamb who was slaughtered. If anyone has an ear, he should listen. If anyone is destined for captivity, into captivity he goes. If it is to be killed with a sword he will be killed. If that's what's going to happen, that's what's going to happen. The Christian, if you belong to Christ tonight, the last thing that you fear is death. Okay, and as an unbeliever, that was one of the biggest reliefs for me when I became a Christian, because I faced death twice as a young man. I got into a very serious accident in a van where I should be dead, and I almost drowned trying to help a person who was drowning. I was the flotation device. One of my greatest fears, well, for human beings in general, one of our greatest fears is just fear of the unknown. But when your life is in his hand and nobody can snatch you out of his hand, you're in the safest place in the world. You know, so when you have eternal life, you don't fear death. And I don't fear death anymore. And that was an awesome change in my present life, amongst other things. This demands the perseverance and faith of the saints. In closing in that verse. Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb. So this one looks like a lamb. And in the scriptures, who's identified as the Lamb of God? Jesus is. So we got somebody who may look like an imposter. But he sounded like a dragon. He exercises all the authority of the first beast on his behalf and compels the earth and those who live on it to worship the first beast, whose fatal wound was healed. He also performs great signs, even causing fire to come down from heaven to earth in front of people. He deceives those who live on the earth because of the signs that he is permitted to perform on behalf of the beast, telling those who live on the earth to make an image of the beast who had the sword wound and yet lived. He was permitted to give a spirit to the image of the beast so that the image of the beast could both speak and cause whoever would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. And he requires everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to be given a mark on his right hand or on his forehead so that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark, the beast's name or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. The one who has understanding must calculate the number of the beast because it is the number of a man. His number is 666. We're going to conclude this with a short passage in Revelation chapter 20. Just a word about the 666 number. Something that is really, it's just a fascinating thing. We see all these things about the microchip technology, how that can be implanted in either the right hand or forehead. It's ran by a lithium battery, and the lithium battery is recharged from the fluctuation of heat in the human body. And the two places in the human body that fluctuate in heat the most is the top of the right hand and the forehead. And today when you go to the grocery store and you buy your groceries, you know, if anybody has studied this, you've read about this, how the barcoding system, all those lines in the barcode have that number 666 embedded in it. So if that is in the chips or somehow, I mean, I don't know how that's all going to tie in, but Scripture foretells that unless we receive that mark, and in the Greek, it's another interesting thing too, the mark is a mark to be received by puncture. Okay? Another very interesting fact about that, about the mark, when the Bible speaks of the mark of the beast. Revelation is just such a fascinating book. But in Revelation chapter 20, in Revelation chapter 19, I'm just going to end with this reading, starting in verse 11, 19:11. Then I saw heaven opened, and there was a white horse. Its rider is called Faithful and True, and he judges and makes war in righteousness. His eyes were like a fiery flame, and many crowns were on his head. He had a name written that no one knows except himself. He wore a robe stained with blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies that were in heaven followed him on white horses, wearing pure white linen. A sharp sword came from his mouth so that he might strike the nations with it. He will shepherd them with an iron scepter. He will also trample the winepress of the fierce anger of God, the Almighty. And he has a name written on his robe and on his thigh, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw an angel standing on the sun, and he cried in a loud voice, saying to all the birds flying overhead, Come, gather together for the great supper of God, so that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of commanders, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and of their riders, and of the flesh of everyone, both free and slave, small and great. Then I saw the beast, the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to wage war against the rider on the horse and against his army. But the beast was taken prisoner, and along with him the false prophet, that second beast we just read about, who had performed the signs in his presence. He deceived those who accepted the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image with these signs. Both of them were thrown alive into the lake of fire that burns with sulfur. The rest were killed with the sword that came from the mouth of the rider on the horse, and all the birds were filled with their flesh. I think we covered enough tonight to know a real thorough history of events that are going to happen when the Antichrist comes, all the way through the setup of the abomination of desolation. We're going to see another beast who's going to be his false prophet, who will perform signs and wonders in his presence, even make apparently this idol appear to be alive. And if people don't worship it, will be put to death. We see the perseverance and the persecution of the saints during this time, but we see our reward happening when he returns, because we are the ones who will inherit the kingdom. We will have bodies like his that are supernatural, that are not dependent upon blood for its life. Because right now, Jesus shed his blood for our sins. His body is sustained purely by the power of God. And the Apostle John says that when he appears, we will be like him. We'll be transformed into, we'll receive that celestial body. So let's conclude with that, and let's pray. Does anybody have any questions about anything that we covered tonight? Okay. Let's pray. Lord God, we praise you and we thank you, Father, for your awesome word. We thank you for opening our eyes and giving us the ability to understand when we come before you with humble and open hearts, Lord God. We just thank you for revealing these things to all of us as to babes. And we just ask that this word would just take plant and root in our hearts, and that it would just cause us to hunger and thirst more to study your word and to grow closer in a relationship with you, Father. We just ask all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Okay. And Pastor will be back on Sunday. There was a slight operation he had, so he couldn't come tonight. And we'll see you all on Sunday.